Ladies and gentlemen, I am really pleased to welcome you tonight for our second launch of the year from the Guiana Space Center, the 73rd already for Ariane 5. Tonight, our heavy lift vehicle is set to deliver into an optimized geostationary transfer orbit, ASTRA 5B for SES in Luxembourg and Amazonas 4A for Hispasat in Spain. Our launcher will be required a performance of 9.5 tons and will have a window of 57 minutes to lift off, opening precisely at 10:04 PM Universal Time. The mission will last a little less than 35 minutes. I would like to thank SES for entrusting Arianespace to deliver into orbit another of its satellites. Once on location at 31.5 degrees east, ASTRA 5B will provide direct-to-home aside cable and digital terrestrial television broadcast services over Europe. It is worth highlighting that ASTRA 5B also hosts a navigation payload for the European Commission in the frame of the European Geostationary Navigation Overlay Service, EGNOS. I am also grateful to Hispasat for placing again its confidence in Arianespace to continue its South American expansion with the Amazonas product line. Amazonas 4A will provide a variety of telecommunication services over South America. It will enhance the current capacity offered by Amazonas 2 and Amazonas 3, also launched by Ariane 5, in anticipation of the peak demands expected during the upcoming FIFA World Cup and Olympic Games, both organized in Brazil in 2014 and 2016. As a European company, Arianespace is proud to be in charge of a fully European launch mission to serve private operators like SES and Hispasat, as well as public entities like the European Commission. And tonight's launch can be considered as a forerunner of what 2014 will be in terms of operational activity, a year very much focused on European space programs, in particular with the initial deployment of Copernicus and Galileo space segments for the European Commission. But our 73rd Ariane 5 is now being readied for launch, so enjoy the show.
Welcome. We are live at the Guiana Space Center and Ariane 5 is on the pad going through the final preparations before tonight's launch. A huge welcome to everybody who's joining us here to watch this launch tonight, in particular to our studio audience. I know a lot of you have come a long way for the launch, so it's great to see you. And of course, welcome to everybody watching at home. This is Mission Control, and behind me is what we call the fishbowl. This is where the operational teams are going through the final procedures for tonight's launch. Everyone's concentrating very hard. And our programme comes to you in both French and English tonight. In the English commentary box is Claude Bernard. Hi, Claude. And for the French team, we have Pierre Junier and Yves Aumont. Hello, guys.
Pierre Junier and Yves Aumont.
Merci Katie, bonsoir à tous, bonsoir Yves.
Bonsoir Pierre, bonsoir à tous.
Good evening Pierre. We are here standing on the outdoor terrace. We are 15 kilometers away from the launch pad. This is where Ariane 5 will lift off. So let's talk about the various stages of the launchers. In the lower part, we have the two solid rocket boosters, and they are on either side of the main cryogenic stage with the Vulcan engine. And above this is the upper stage, and this is where the onboard computers are located. And at the very top, the fairing housing our two passengers, Astra 5B and Amazonas 4A. Schedule time is 7:04 p.m. local time or 11:04 p.m. Paris time, with a window of launch for 58 minutes. Back to you, Katie.
Big, strong, reliable launcher, our Ariane, with an excellent track record. So we thought we'd walk you around some of the teams working here in Mission Control. This is the Flight Directorate, the Arianespace top management. They take all the important decisions if there is an unplanned situation. And the teams working across the base report directly to them in real time. So you'll be seeing them on the phones throughout the mission, keeping in touch with everybody. And behind me, you can see these are the status panels. All the different systems across the range feed their status to these panels. Right now, they're all green, so we are go for launch. So, Yves and Pierre, we have two very precious passengers on board, don't we?
Oui, ils sont très précieux.
Yes, indeed, they are very valuable. And the upper position, we have our first customer, ASTRA 5B. Let's talk about them. ASTRA 5B, at liftoff, weighs 5,724 kilos, built by Airbus Defence and Space, on a Eurostar 3000 platform. This is a communications satellite covering Eastern Europe. The satellite in the lower position, underneath the Silda, is Amazonas 4A for our client, Hispasat. It weighs in at 2,937 kilos. It's a telecommunications satellite for all of South America, built by Orbital Sciences Corporation. Tonight's launch is for two of Arianespace's very valued customers. First of all, SES. This is the second-ranked telecommunications company in the world, and Arianespace actually launched their first satellite over 25 years ago. Hispasat has a fleet of six satellites. It covers 100% of requirements of Spanish-speaking South America. These are two loyal customers, but let's go back to Katie.
Thank you very much indeed, guys. So, continuing our walk around the Mission Control building, we have two teams for the satellite side, one team for ASTRA 5B and the other for Amazonas. And the mission director tonight is Jean-Marc Durand. He coordinates the day-to-day activities here at the base. Now, somebody else who's very important for us to keep our eye on, or actually listen out
à
for,
tous de DDO.
Is the range
attention
operations
pour la séquence
director.
Finale lanceur.
Tonight, it's Laura Apolloni.
Top. H0 moins 7 minutes.
And she's just announced a very important key milestone in the last final phase of the countdown. It's the last 7 minutes, the synchronized sequence or automated sequence, during which time the computers take over the job of the final operations. Pierre and Yves, over to you.
Merci, Katie. Eh bien, oui, il faut savoir qu'il y a une campagne.
Yes, there is first a launcher campaign that is conducted by Arianespace, and then there's satellite campaign, and then there's a time when all three of them have to come together. This is what we call the combined operations plan. And here are a few images.
The various parts of the launcher arrived by boat from Europe and were delivered to the launcher integration building, where the main stage was hoisted to the vertical position. The two boosters built here at CSG were transported from storage and attached to the main stage. The whole structure was then hoisted onto the launch table before being transported to the final assembly building. Meanwhile, the satellites arrived at the airport in Cayenne and were transported to the state-of-the-art facilities here at the base, where teams first checked their good health before carefully transporting them for fueling, all this in the safe environment of the dedicated buildings where cleanliness is paramount. The next stage is called the Combined Operations Phase. It involves carefully lowering the spacecraft on top of the launch vehicle under the protective environment of the fairing to form what we call the upper composite. These operations were performed in perfect cooperation between Arianespace and their customer teams. 2 days before launch, the whole ensemble was rolled out to the pad along a dedicated track, all fully integrated on the launch table, with the umbilical tower and supply systems ready to undergo the final preparation. A great campaign with some fantastic cooperation between all of the teams, and our two satellites, I think it's fair to say, are sitting in first class with their seat belts on, very comfortable in there, and an air-conditioned environment. So we were talking about the satellite teams earlier. Here we go. We can see them here. The satellite mission directors represent Arianespace's customers, so they're the ones who decide whether or not the satellite is ready for launch. So we've had a good walk around Mission Control, introduced you to some of the teams here. We are about 15 kilometres from the pad. Launch Control is the other control centre, and that's about 3 kilometres from the pad. Now, I'm going to go up now to join Claude in the commentary box up there, and continue the commentary from there. But Claude's going to run you through now what the guys and girls do in the Launch Control Center.
Thank you, Katie. Yes, we are just entering in a few seconds in the, what we call the bunker, the launch center. There are over 100 people working here in various teams. One is responsible for ground operations. It's led by the Launch Site Operation Manager, or COEL. Frédéric Fakin heads up the first group. He coordinates with Mission Control for final authorization to launch. And when all the conditions are right, he okays the automated sequence of minus 7 minutes. The launch campaign quality is Bernard de Cotigny. He keeps an eye on all the operation to make sure everyone follows the procedure correctly. Another team ensures the flight readiness of the vehicle, led by Ariane Production Manager, or CPAP, Laurent Jourdain. He oversees all the operation from launch vehicle assembly to the moment of launch. And Isabelle Leclerc followed the quality status of the launcher stages, first in Europe and then at the CSG. So what's happening now? About a minute ago on the launch vehicle side, the computers here send the liftoff time to the computers on board, and we have stopped the topping up of the upper stage tank. Okay, we will leave this and we are going to the terrace again with Pierre and Yves. To you.
Merci Claude. Eh bien, tout en haut du lanceur, vous l'avez aperçu sur
the launcher, you will have seen on the images, there are two flexible ducts that supply the satellites under the fairing. And below this, there are yellow cryogenic arms that are providing a continuous supply of cryogenic propellant to the upper stage. The propellant is loaded through the tanking plates, and these plates are ventilated with helium. The purpose here is to avoid any icing hump that could be caused by cryopumping, because if there were formation of ice on the plates, they could no longer be released. A very important piece of information, the helium does not liquefy at the temperature of liquid hydrogen. Here you can see on the left liquid hydrogen at minus 253 degrees Celsius, on the right liquid oxygen at minus 180 degrees Celsius. These tanking plates will be disconnected, will be released. This will happen very quickly, and then the arms will retract. This is at H0 minus 5 seconds, and then that means that liftoff is imminent. Let's go to the sites receiving us remotely. SES in The Hague and Betzdorf, Hispasat in Madrid, ISPAMA in Brazil. But let's listen now to the Range Operations Director.
Voilà, on continue à dire coucou à Airbus au Muro et à Toulouse.
And Airbus is following us in Les Mureaux and Toulouse, and Arianespace in Evry, and all of our other partners in Europe. So Yves, maybe we can go ahead and talk a little bit about H0. At H0, we'll see the Vulcan engine being ignited, then a very short test will follow, then the rocket boosters will be ignited, and it's the power of the thrust of the boosters will make it possible for the rocket to lift off. We'd like to greet all the people following us on the internet. Let's now let the images speak for themselves.
A tous des DDO. Attention pour les décomptes finales. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, top. Allumage Vulcan. Allumage EAP. Décollage. Les paramètres à bord sont nominaux. Les paramètres à bord sont conformes à l'attendu.
Eh bien, c'est comme d'habitude, c'est phénoménal, c'est époustouflant.
As always, it's absolutely amazing. It's too quick and with a very low cloud cover. But we are talking about 1,300 tons of thrust. That's the equivalent of 60 aircraft engines. And the two boosters are producing 90% of the power of the launcher. And the consumption rate is close to 2 tons of propellant per second. In 2 minutes, 240 tons of propellant will have been consumed. Yes, you can hear the extraordinary noise levels. Being on the terrace here, we can truly feel the power through these shock waves of sound. As you know, that our cameras will simply not be able to track the launcher for very long, so we'll have to go back to the trajectory that you see on the screens. This reflects in real time the trajectory of Ariane 5, because there's a little square that is moving along the predicted trajectory. You can see now on the bottom part of your screens, to the left, altitude in kilometers, to the right, speed in kilometers per second. In the sky above Kourou that is overcast, in a few moments, the boosters that are manufactured here in Guyana will have completed their mission, and the launcher will be able to jettison these empty boosters as 36 tons each, so 72 tons will be shed, but this is not counting, of course, the mass of the propellant. These boosters will be separated thanks to a pyro cutting of the rods, and to avoid any collision with the central body of the launcher, 8 distancing rockets push them away. We just saw it on these 3D images, and here we can see it from the onboard camera images. The mass at launch was 773 tons, but it slimmed down very fast, indeed, because it shed over 500 tons, that is two-thirds of its launch mass, but there's still 230 tons in flight. The next stage will be when the fairing is jettisoned. The fairing protects the passengers against pollution, against acoustic vibrations at liftoff, and against aerodynamic heating due to friction, but that's for the early stage of flight. But above an altitude of about 100 kilometers, the atmosphere is a near vacuum. There's no longer any heating induced by friction, so the fairing can be jettisoned safely for the two satellites. In fact, we've just seen this. It is jettisoned at an altitude of 111 kilometers. It splits in half, and it seems to fall back into the ocean. 2.5 tons less on the launcher. And of course, once the launcher mass decreases, the faster it can go. This is a 17-meter high fairing. It's made of a special honeycomb material. In just a few instants, we're going to re-experience liftoff. It took place less than 4 minutes ago, very quick, because the cloud cover is very low. Look at the images. Everything goes very fast. Ariane 5 is almost like a bolt, and it disappeared very quickly. What did you feel, Eve? You had not seen such a liftoff for a long time. The last Ariane rocket that I'd seen from the outside was Ariane 4 with liquid propellant. And here I would say that the major difference is, of course, the extraordinarily flash of light that we see. In fact, we saw the whole skyline lighten up. And also the astonishing acceleration, Mach 1 in 49 seconds. It was indeed impressive, maybe short, unfortunately, because of the low cloud cover. This is the third replay. It's almost the most magnificent. And you can see the cameras are actually shaking. We'll now be coming back inside. And we will carry on commenting other images for the rest of the mission. Now for the news.
The first launch of 2014 took place on the 6th of February, and Ariane 5 flawlessly performed her 58th successful launch in a row, orbiting two satellites, ABS-2 for the operator ABS and Athena Fidus for Telespazio, on behalf of the French and Italian space agencies.
At Satellite 2014, the chairman and CEO of Arianespace, Stefan Israel, called for the US to open its government market to international launch services competition and said Arianespace was ready to bid for opportunities.
The European Space Agency has a new director of launchers. Following in the footsteps of the highly respected Antonio Fabrizi, Gayle Winters says Arianespace is a unique position to compete in world markets.
Today is an important day. An important day for Arianespace with this new launch of Ariane 5, but also an important day for the customers who have put confidence in this launcher and want to see their satellites in space to be integrated in their business. We have a unique situation in Europe with a system of three launchers, Vega, Ariane 5, and Soyuz, capable of responding to the requirements of all customers worldwide. A unique system which works very well. But it's not the end of the story. In this business, one has to develop, one has to make new technologies, one has to increase the performance of the launcher. That is very important, and that is exactly what we are working on. We in ESA, together with industry, with the national centers and Arianespace, are working on improvement of the Vega launcher, a significant improvement of Ariane 5, and also the preparation of the development of a new launcher, Ariane 6. This is the way to go for the future. This is the way to go to maintain our access to space in the future and to respond to customer needs and to continue the success of the present European launch system.
Arianespace is to orbit OPSAT 3000 for the Italian company CGS SPA and Venus for the Israeli Space Agency, together in a dual launch on board Vega in 2016.
We are preparing five launches at the same time as the CSG. Ariane 5 will soon be ready to fit Optus 10 and MeSAT 3B for a launch in May.
The fifth automated transfer vehicle, named after the Belgian cosmologist Georges Lemaître, is scheduled to launch on board Ariane 5 in July, destined for the International Space Station.
Soyuz number 7 to launch here at the CSG is planned for 3rd of April to orbit the European Space Agency's Earth observation satellite, Sentinel-1A.
And the light lifter of the Arianespace family, Vega, is being ready to launch Kazakhstan's first Earth observation satellite, DZZHR, built by Airbus Defence and Space. Well, hello again. I'm back in the commentary box with Claude. And we're hearing there from the Range Operations Director that everything is going according to plan. Claude, we're tracking the launcher using ground stations as she flies over. It's called telemetry, isn't it? We've just received a signal from the second one, that's Natal in Brazil.
Yes, it is. And Ariane sends data to ground stations. It tells us how the flight is progressing in real time. And later, we will analyze this data to see how the vehicle performed. We call it, in our language, the level zero flight evaluation.
So we can see that the main stage has now cut off its engine. And it's falling back away. We've jettisoned it, and we are switching on the upper stage. So we're shedding weight.
And we started with 773 tons, and now we have approximately 28 tons left. That's only 3% of our original mass.
So we are looking now at, for anyone who's unfamiliar with what we're looking at, on the left-hand side you can see the disc. First of all, you can see the motor, the blue flame. The disc, the grey and white disc, is the upper stage. And then we have the, in the centre there, you can see on the right-hand side of the screen, the black is the cylinder, and we have Astra 5B at the front. So we're now burning the upper stage. Its job is to deliver the satellites to their transfer orbit, Claude. That's the position in space where they can separate from the launcher.
And this upper stage is a complex piece of engineering with a cryogenic propellant inside, of course, 15 tons worth, and it will burn approximately 16 minutes.
Claude, talk us through this curve. If you look on the top right-hand side of the screen, you can see that curve there. All eyes on that at this point in the launch.
And this curve is a computer simulation of the trajectory, showing the exact flight events, like the velocity, the altitude, and all the separations. And you see there is a white dot on the curve. This is the actual position of the launch vehicle. The speed, it's 7.13 kilometers per second, and we are flying at 172 kilometers high.
So, if you look at the trajectory, you can see that we climbed very steeply initially. We've sort of plateaued out, and we're actually losing a bit of altitude before we gain altitude again. What's that about, Claude? Because we often call this, don't we, the roller coaster.
And we will decrease our altitude a little. Don't forget that the mass of the launcher decreased too. So this is why we're taking more speed, and we will use all the thrust to increase our speed. And this helps to push us towards our destination, 612 kilometers above the Earth. And at that point, we will be traveling at 9.4 kilometers per second.
All the teams there. Everybody concentrating hard. And the range operations manager calling out the key milestones during this launch. ASTRA at the front, the SILDA, the black section in the middle, and the upper stage at the back there, powering us through space. And you can see the curvature of the Earth. It's quite something. Quite something to look at. Our first satellite to be separated is ASTRA 5B. It was built by Airbus Defence and Space using their Eurostar 3000 platform, and that's for their customer SES, the Luxembourg operator. Arianespace and SES have developed an exceptional relationship over the last couple of decades. It's fair to say, I think, and ASTRA 5B is the 39th SES to fly on Europe's launcher.
ASTRA 5B is it's a very large satellite. It's a six-ton satellite, in fact. It's the fourth of our Astrium satellites, which was to be launched here in this particular sequence. It's the eighth Eurostar satellite that we've actually purchased from Astrium. So it's a well-known, it's a well-developed and extremely reliable spacecraft. ASTRA 5B is our latest satellite in our Astrium set of procurements. It's going to fly at 31.5 degrees east, has 40 KU band transponders and 6 KA band transponders. Its primary mission is the development of DTH in Eastern Europe and in Russia. It's basically there to allow new entrants into the DTH world the opportunity to develop their platforms and to start developing their business. It's to allow contribution of digital feeds to both to cable, direct digital terrestrial transmission distribution systems. It allows us also to develop the broadband activities in Eastern Europe, both with Ka band, where we have 6 transponders, and Ku band, where we have 40 transponders. There's one other aspect which is also very interesting with 5B, and that's it. We're flying a host of payloads. We're flying the second of our EGNOS payloads. This is an augmentation payload to allow GPS to be more accurate and allows like aircraft to use it. It allows a very, very accurate measurement of our position on the ground, so for surveying and such like. It's a big step forward, and it forms a cornerstone of the EU's Galileo system for the future. The orbital slot at 31.5 east is a major development area for us. We started at 19.2, we then went to 28.2, we developed 23.5, we're developing 5 degrees east, and now 31.5 is the next part of that puzzle. It's the next part of the solution. Yeah, we're very excited about this launch, and we're ready to take control of this and to be successful for another 15 years with it.
So we are 15 minutes and 23 seconds into the flight, and the upper stage is powering us across the Atlantic towards Africa. Our flight path takes us virtually along the equator, and maybe for people who are not familiar with the flight, Claude, you could just detail the tracking stations that are going to pick us up.
So first tracking station is here in Kourou, called Galio. Second one is Natal in Brazil. Then by the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, we have Ascension Island. On the west coast of Africa in Gabon, we have Libreville. And the final one is Malindi in Kenya, east coast, in Africa, of course. And this one will pick all the information concerning the two separation of satellites and the separation of the signal.
So Malindi is the tracking station that will be watching the separations. And, there's quite a lot of advantages, aren't there, from launching from the equator, but notably, we are here. It's the fastest route to orbit.
Exactly. And due to the natural rotation of the Earth, this gives additional speed at the equator. And here in French Guiana, we're at 5 degrees north, so it's very close from the equator. So the launcher is already moving in the right direction, even on the pad when we are launching east, of course. This is not the case when we are launching north.
And she says that all the parameters are nominal. Everything's going according to plan. Now, we're very lucky because we've got these fantastic images that we can look at. These are computer-generated images. And these are actually effectively what is really happening in space. So these are predictions.
These are the predictions, the calculated one, exactly, as I said, with same altitude, same distance, same speed, all the different separation and all the position in the sky at every moment. So this is really true, okay? And it corresponds exactly at the position of the launch vehicle in the sky.
So when you see in the images, you see the launcher moving or twisting, or you see a white flash or an engine.
This happened on board.
You're actually saying, yes, what is planned to be happening in space right at that moment in time. So we're coming up to the next tracking station is going to be Libreville. We're crossing the water, crossing the pond, crossing the Atlantic and heading towards the west coast of Africa. And we're going to be getting that acquisition in a couple of seconds' time, but I just think it's incredible, Claude, to think that we've managed to cross the Atlantic in less than 20 minutes, just over 18 minutes. 6 hours in a transatlantic jet.
Thanks to the principle of suborbital flight. And this is, of course, combination of speed and altitude. And soon we will be able to do Madrid to Brasilia in around 2 hours.
Well, that'll be something. And there we have. Acquisition in Libreville. We've reached the west coast of Africa. Orbital Sciences Corporation built Amazonas 4A.
The Hispasat group continues to grow. A new satellite is joining its fleet, so that we can continue to offer the most innovative services. So that we can further strengthen our position at the cutting edge of satellite communications. So that we remain a benchmark operator in Latin America. So that we continue to spearhead the distribution of content in Spanish and Portuguese. The Hispasat Group is launching its 11th satellite, the Amazonas 4A. Amazonas 4A will be operated by Hispamar Satellites, the group's Brazilian joint venture. The satellite provides additional space capacity for Latin America. The coverage extends from Venezuela and Colombia to southern Argentina and Chile. Built by Orbital Sciences Corporation, the new satellite is based on a Geostar 2.4E platform. It has a wingspan of 23 meters and stands 4.7 meters tall. It carries a payload of 24 Ku-band transponders, operating simultaneously two deployable antennas and three-axis attitude control, guaranteeing high-precision pointing. At the end of its lifetime, it will have a payload power of more than 7 kilowatts. The Spanish industry, Thales Alenia Space España, RIMSA, INSA, GMV, and Indra also played a key role in the construction of the Amazonas 4A and in its ground segment. With a liftoff mass around 3 tons, the fleet's new satellite will be carried into space from the Kourou base in French Guiana, on board Arianespace Ariane 5 ECA launch vehicle. The Amazonas 4A is especially designed to provide audiovisual services. Its high capacity guarantees efficient and reliable communications for the deployment of platforms for the broadcast and distribution of content. Latin America is growing. The Hispasat Group is growing. Amazonas 4A. More capacity, better services.
So it's very exciting. We can't actually see Amazonas 4A because it's underneath the cylinder. That's the black structure in the middle. So, Claude, we are 22 minutes in. Before, we were using all our power to get away from the Earth's gravity, and now we're using it to go faster and higher. We're really starting to climb now, aren't we?
We need to increase our speed and altitude to get the injection point. That's where we can separate the two satellites, okay? We have to get 912 kilometers above the Earth to eject Astra 5B, and then we keep traveling to 2,450 kilometers where we will eject Amazonas 4A.
So it's quite a big distance, isn't it, between the two?
Of course.
And if you look on the right-hand side of the screen, the top right-hand side, you can see that roller coaster effect that Claude was explaining to us earlier. And you can see our spacecraft heading up there now, really getting up high into space. So we are coming up to... She says we have 2 minutes left of propulsion on the upper stage. So we're heading now towards the east coast.
De la télémesure Lancer par la station de Malindi au Kenya.
So we've arrived over the east coast of Africa at the Malindi tracking station. This is where, Claude, you were saying the guys and girls will be tracking the separation of the launcher. You know what, Claude, tell us the speed and altitude.
So the speed now is 9.16 kilometers per second, and we are flying at 470 kilometers high. And another information, the distance where the launch vehicle is regarding the ground route from Kourou is 8,473 kilometers.
So we've traveled. It's huge, isn't it? In only 23, just coming up for 24
yes.
minutes, quite something. And I have to say, I'm going to repeat that speed, which is now 9 kilometres and 23 metres. 9 kilometres per second. It's really remarkable. So the upper stage has a brain. It's very smart.
We call it the Vehicle Equipment Bay. Inside, we found the two onboard computers. These computers can even make decisions. They take into account information from the tank, the engine, all the different parts of the upper stage. And if there are different options, it always chooses the one who maximizes the success of the mission.
And that vehicle equipment bay is the windlass. As we see the upper stage turning around here, we should be able to see. Now, Claude, just remind me, is it the white part of the disc or is it the grey?
No, the white part is the vehicle equipment bay and the grey one is the upper stage. But they're attached. They arrive here in Kourou, attached together.
And we are coming up now for the scheduled cutoff of the...
Extension de l'étage supérieur cryogénique.
And we have confirmation there from Laura Apolloni that the upper stage has now switched off its engine. So we are entering what's called the ballistic...
Début de la manœuvre d'orientation au profit du satellite Astra 5B.
The ballistic phase, and that means, ballistic actually means with no propulsion. So we've switched off our engine and we're travelling on our own steam now, Claude.
Exactly, because now we are on orbit. We can separate satellites. The speed is okay, the altitude is okay, so high enough and fast enough to cruise without the engine, okay? This is what you call the space ballet.
Yes, this is what we often call the space ballet, this phase now where the satellites have to be orientated and twisted and turned and put in the correct position. What's actually happening, Claude?
Now, we are giving an orientation to the upper composite. Once we release the satellites, they continue their journey on their own to the final orbit. And to do that, we must put them on the correct position and also the right altitude. This is very precise. And this is exactly what the upper stage is doing now in order to separate in very few seconds now the first satellite, Astra 5B.
And if you look at those images, you can see that light blue line around the outside edge of the planet is our atmosphere. Always quite remarkable to look at that and to realise that that's all that separates us from the vast expanse of space.
Fin de la manœuvre d'orientation au profil du satellite Astra 5B.
So that's the end of...
End of the manoeuvre, the orientation manoeuvre. And we are climbing,
Now, what distance did you say we needed to get to?
Par la station de Libreville,
au we get the speed, 914, so we can separate.
So we are at the correct speed and we have to get to the correct altitude.
And separation du satellite Astra 5B.
And we have separation of Astra 5B. You can see it moving away there in space. It's now heading out on its journey. What happens to it now, Claude?
In 2 hours and 13 minutes from now, just after the separation, we'll have the partial deployment of the solar arrays. During the four next day, the orbit
début
will be
de la manœuvre d'orientation circular au profit du système de lancement double Ariane.
Sorry, and 6 days, we will have the full solar array deployment and the opening of the reflectors. And 11 days later, the teams at the Mission Control Center will get to take charge of the satellite in Belsdorf in Luxembourg.
So, congratulations to the SES teams and to all the teams involved in Astra 5B. We still have Amazonas 4A attached, and we have about 5 minutes to go before we can separate it.
La manœuvre d'orientation se poursuit nominalement.
But now so we have the two Melindi, box.
Yes, yeah. And there's the Melindi tracking station we were looking at there. A few words about SES. The company was founded in 1985, and it was the first European private satellite operator originally to offer broadcasting services in Europe. So, Claude, it was really revolutionary, wasn't it, at the time?
It certainly was. And it grew very quickly. Sorry. They acquired G-Americom in 2001 and New Sky Satellite in 2006. Total... the group SES is the second largest satellite company in the world. And now with Astra 5B, I think I'm right in saying that they have a fleet of 54 satellites in orbit.
So we still have Amazonas 4A attached. And it's, as I said, going to be a few minutes before we separate it. And just talk us through what's happening here, Claude, and just talk us through our speed and altitude, because we're actually now losing speed, aren't we? We're not travelling as fast.
We are increasing the altitude, but the velocity, of course, there is no more power. So even if we are in ballistics, the velocity is decreasing, okay? And to get the SILDA separation velocity, we must be at 8.26. We are at 8.79, so we have to decrease again. And they are the stage is giving, so the orientation, as we said, we have three phases orientation in order to put the Silda cover in a good direction in order not to avoid maneuvers with the satellites.
So we were talking earlier about the vehicle equipment bay. It's sending signals to the ground stations. What happens to the information? What are we looking at here?
Here we are in the telemetry station here at CSG. It's called the CVI, the real-time visual control. The team is managed by Nathalie Philippe from Arianespace. Remember, Ariane sends information to the tracking stations as she flies over. Well, those tracking stations then send the data here to the CVI in Kourou. And the goal is to know if the flight is on track and if all the parameters are correct. And this is why Laura is repeating everything is correct, okay? She heard from the CVI. They receive more than 100 pieces of information at any time, and the team makes a quick selection to check how the flight is progressing. Later on, they will analyze the whole flow of thousands of parameters in order to give first the total cover of the whole flight and also to correct any detected anomaly before the next flight. And she announced, as I said, Nathalie, the key milestone to the flight directorate and to the launch operation manager in CDL and to the range operation manager here in Laura.
And then Laura Apolloni, the range operations manager, then announces it to all the rest of us. So we are travelling higher and slower. As we were saying, Amazonas requires a much higher delivery position than Astra. We are still climbing. Let's just reflect on some of these distances and speeds here, Claude.
The speed is decreasing again. Okay. We separate Astra at 912 and at 914 kilometers per second. We need to be at 8.26 kilometers per second to separate the Silda at an altitude of 2,104. And we are only at 1,839. So we have to climb again and to decrease the speed.
Every now and again, we can see some little white flashes. What are those?
We have on board six small thrusters, three on each side, to control the yaw, the pitch, and the roll. And they can twist it in any direction we want. And they use bursts of coal gas to open and close. And you know that every satellite has its specific attitude of separation. This is why we are going now, not for the moment, but later on, to give the good orientation to Amazonas.
Now, we're talking about that black structure at the front. This is called a silda. It's a little bit like a small fairing, isn't it? Because it's protecting...
It's protecting the inner satellite, Amazonas. It makes dual launch possible on Ariane 5. Silda means dual launch system, okay? So it protects Amazonas, we said it, but it provides also the attachment mechanism for Astra 5B, and Astra 5B was on top.
And it's going to separate now. We are on the scheduled Silda separation moment. So there we go. We have separation now of the Silda, and we can see Amazonas 4A for the first time. There it is. It's, as you were saying, Claude, it's...
De la manœuvre d'orientation au profit du satellite Amazonas 4A.
We can see the two solar panels there on each side of Amazonas. And the upper stage is going through the orientation manoeuvres. A few words about Hispasat. Amazonas 4A will be the eighth Spanish satellite to launch with Arianespace. And Claude, we first orbited Hispasat 1A and 1B back in 1992 and 1993. And you worked on that, didn't you?
Yes, I was mission director at the time for Hispasat 1A. It was on flight 53 and with an Ariane 4. And can I remember that Prince Felipe was here in Kourou, he's the son of the King of Spain.
You were in very prestigious company. So just tell us a little bit about what happens to Amazonas 4A after separation.
Amazonas 4A will be separated with a slow spin of 1 degree per second. But after that, during its flight, it will be a three-axis stabilized mode during all the in-orbit life.
There you see those white flashes, and you can see that curve on the right-hand side.
We get the speed, we get the altitude.
Okay, so we're in the right place.
Separation du satellite Amazonas 4A.
And we have separation of Amazonas 4A. Huge congratulations to everybody. Congratulations to all the teams. And big slaps on the back all round. Everybody's
It was a very
worked.
Short journey, isn't it?
It was a short journey.
Only 34 minutes.
Yeah. And we covered, I didn't look on the screen to see what distance we had covered at the end there, but that was a beautiful launch. Everything went like clockwork. So congratulations, everybody.
Could I have something concerning the...
Tell us about what's going to happen next.
It will take 8 days to circularize the orbit, and on day plus eight, the full solar array deployment and the opening of the reflectors also, and then the people of the mission control in Madrid will take charge of the satellite for its life. And I recall something, don't forget that the satellite will be fully operational in time to cover the Football World Cup in Brazil this summer and the Olympics in 2016, also in Brazil.
That's the important stuff. I think there are going to be a few smiling faces knowing that people will be able to watch those hugely important sporting events. And let's look back again at that super separation of Amazonas 4A, moving away from the upper stage. But of course, the job of the upper stage is not finished.
It will be reoriented on another position, again, to avoid the maneuvers with the satellites. And we will empty the remaining propellant inside the tanks. But it will take, let's say, 1 hour, no more.
So we're going to watch that launch again. There it was, over 35 minutes ago now, a beautiful launch from the Guiana Space Center here on the edge of the Amazon rainforest, carrying our two new babies, both of which are heading off on their own journey into space. And we can see the teams there looking very, very happy. Big smiles. We're waiting now for some of the key people to come and talk to us. There we go. Some of the teams there. Feels good, doesn't it?
Claude? Teams from ASTRA, from ECS. Yeah. And this is Spaceport and Amazonas.
It certainly feels good to be to know that the satellite is now starting its journey. And of course, let's not forget, Claude, that there are the two control centres in Luxembourg and Madrid. And let's just say hello to the teams there, because they will be really concentrating
hard. The job begins for them.
Yeah, absolutely. So Ariane's job is done, but the job is just beginning now for those teams.
So 34 minutes to go. And a life of 15 years.
Les élus, so distinguished customers and guests, German. Ladies and gentlemen, one more. I have just got the confirmation that Ariane 5 accomplished its 59th successful mission in a row. It is an honor for Arianespace to announce that Astra 5B and Amazonas 4A were both separated onto their targeted geostationary transfer orbits. In upper position, Astra 5B is the 39th satellite launched by Arianespace belonging to SES fleet since 1988. Beyond this long history of mutual trust and loyalty, tonight's launch has special importance to us as Astra 5B hosts a navigation payload, EGNOS, for the European Commission. I would like to take this opportunity to thank Martin Halliwell, SES Chief Technical Officer, for his presence here tonight. I would also like to thank the SES team for their patience and flexibility in preparation for this launch. Martin, it is good to have you back in CSG one more time, and we are ready to welcome you for many future SES launches. I want also to send my greetings to Romain Bosch, SES President and CEO, for a few more days to come. Let me congratulate Romain for his outstanding achievements during nearly 20 years at the helm of SES. Many thanks also to Christophe Coates, representing the European Commission's Directorate General Enterprise and Industry, for attending this launch here with us tonight. You can be sure that Arianespace is fully committed to making 2014 a cornerstone of the European Commission space program, with the initial deployment of both Copernicus and Galileo full operational constellation. Last but not least, congratulations to our friends of Airbus Defence and Space, manufacturer of ASTRA 5B. Indeed, tonight's launch was the 15th performed by Ariane 5, with a Eurostar 3000 platform on board, built by Airbus in its Toulouse satellite plant. We are proud of this record, which shows the competitiveness of European space technologies in both the satellite and launch services commercial businesses. As a second passenger on this flight, Amazonas 4A is the sixth satellite launched by Arianespace for Hispasat, which celebrates its 25th anniversary this year. And the third of the Amazonas series focused on expanding Hispasat's business over South America. No doubt that Amazonas 4A will soon be broadcasting images of La Roja's victory in the upcoming FIFA World Cup in Brazil. If France does not win, we'll see. So let me express my deepest gratitude to Mrs. Elena Pisonero, president of Hispasat, who is with us tonight, as well as to Carlos Espinos, chief executive officer, for electing Arianespace as a launch service provider of the Amazonas product line. Thanks also to Antonio Abad, chief technical officer, for sharing this success with us in CLG. Let me also extend our gratitude to the Spanish space and economic community, who is represented here tonight by so many distinguished guests. Spain's support and industrial contribution to the Ariane program has never weakened. Muchas gracias. Of course, I also congratulate our friends at Orbital Sciences Corporation, Amazonas 4A manufacturer, for preparing this satellite for launch. This is the 25th orbital satellite launch with Arianespace. We appreciate our steadfast partnership. We are now, all of us, in a very busy time here at Europe Spaceport. As a matter of fact, and after tonight's mission's completion, there are still no less than four launch campaigns being conducted in parallel at the CSG, involving our entire launcher family, two on Ariane 5, one on Soyuz, and one on Vega. I checked these future missions this morning in CSG, and they are all on track. In this context, you will allow me to congratulate the Arianespace teams, both in Europe and in French Guiana. Tonight, alongside with all our partners, we made one step more on the way to our very challenging target this year, up to 12 launches with our family of launch vehicles. Thank you very much. I wish also to spotlight all our industrial partners. Under the leadership of our prime contractors, Airbus Defence and Space for Ariane 5, ELV for Vega, and Roscosmos for Soyuz, they all perform an outstanding job to get our three launchers reliable and available. Thanks to our contractors here in French Guiana, who all play a key role in implementing our launch operations. Thanks to the CNES team at CSG for their efficient operational support in those times of high workload. Last but not least, my gratitude goes to our long-standing institutional partners, ESA and CNES, both represented tonight by two prestigious guests, Gaëlle Winters, head of ESA Launchers Directorate, and Jean-Yves Le Gall, president of CNES. Many thanks to both of them for sharing this moment with us. As said by Gaëlle during the video transmission, in this year of ESA Ministerial, Arianespace is waiting with an high impatience, the confirmation of the Ariane roadmap, first with Ariane 5 ME and after with Ariane 6, two key projects for European long-term access to space and Ariane competitiveness. I want to take this opportunity to congratulate Jean-Yves on behalf of all Arianespace team, a team he knows quite well, for the top prestigious space award he has just received 2 weeks ago in Washington. I now leave the floor to our customers, first ASTRA 5B and EGNOS, then Amazonas 4A. Then we will have our satellite manufacturers, Airbus and Orbital, and we will have some words from CNES and ESA. Thank you very much for your attention and enjoy this good evening.
Okay, well, good evening, everybody. Don't worry, my speech will not be a long one. First things, as Stefan just mentioned, this is our 39th satellite that has been launched by Ariane. And it's the eighth Airbus Defense Systems satellite within the SES fleet. To start with the thanks, I would very much like to collectively thank ESA, CNES, and especially Stefan and his team. It's really down to the professionalism and the excellence, which is expressed, you know, by those entire team people, that makes what is extremely complicated technically look routine. We sat here, we watched it, it looked so calm, it looked so easy, and it isn't. And it's really due to the extreme professionalism of the teams that make this happen. So I really commend you for that. I'd also like to thank, of course, Airbus Defense Systems for the construction of 5B and all the work that they've done to be prepared for this launch. Of course, I'd like to thank all my colleagues in SES. For them, the operational phase is just beginning. This is the end of the beginning. It has a long life, and they have an awful lot of work to do through the next weeks and months to bring this satellite into service. I'd also like to add good wishes to our co-passenger, Avazonas 4A, but I do have some concerns. And my real concern is that England will not stay in the World Cup long enough to have its matches transmitted through the Amazonas 4A satellite. Thanks very much again to everybody. And we'll see you in a couple of months with our next launch with O3B. Thank you very much indeed, and good evening.
Ladies and gentlemen, excellencies, this was a very impressive moment. For us, for the European Commission, it was not only an impressive moment, but also a crucial moment. Because through the EGNOS transponder that is on board of the ASTRA 5B, we will ensure the continuity of our EGNOS program, and also we are now able to prepare for the future of our EGNOS program thanks to the advanced technology of the transponder on board. Thus, EGNOS will be able to continue to provide valuable positioning services to users all over Europe, be it in the field of aviation, transport, or agriculture. My thanks goes to all those who have contributed to this successful launch today, from those who built the transponder, who integrated it, who launched it, and who will operate it in the future. I will be very short, and I would like to finish, in fact, with a quote from one of the founding fathers of the European community, Robert Schuman. You may have heard about him. He said in a speech in 1950, known as the Schuman Declaration, "Europe will not be made all at once or according to a single plan. It will be built through concrete achievements which create a de facto solidarity." And I think today, again, we saw these concrete European achievements with this launch. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's always the same pleasure to share such a success with our customer SES. It's another step in our large cooperation with you, so it's always the same pleasure. So now we have to leave the floor to the LEOP teams, because the job is not finished. Now we have also to take care of the satellite. So still a lot of work to be performed, but we are in good shape. This success also is shared today with the European Commission with the EGNOS payload. And clearly, SES also has been a key player in the success of this payload on ASTRA 5B. I would like also to thank particularly Arianespace for this new successful launch. As said by Martin, it seems to be easy, but it's a very high level of professionalism which is requested to achieve this performance. I would like also to wish all the best to our co-passenger Amazonas 4A. Of course, I would like also to congratulate all the teams from Airbus Defence and Space, either on the satellite side or the launcher side, which have allowed the design and the manufacturing of the satellite on the launcher. All of this has been possible, I would say, thanks to the fruitful and trustful cooperation with SES. I think it's a key asset to this kind of success. So thank you, and now enjoy the event.
Where is my hat? No, I think I count for three, so no, I'm trying to be brief, but I'm really very pleased and very happy to be here. It's my first time, and I think I have everything, including wind. So, but I'm really proud and very, very satisfied as chairman and as president of Hispasat to share with you the successful launch of Amazonas 4A. The most important thing is about football, and football is already talked by everybody. So what I want to say is, of course, congratulations to SES team for us, our flight companion for launch. And I take the opportunity to thank your understanding and the patience with the last adjustment. So Martin, thank you for your patience. It's our fourth satellite from Amazonas fleet. It's thing in less than 10 years. So I think it's clear that for us, this is 59 seconds. Okay. Oh my God. The wind, the microphone. So come on, let's start again. The strategic focus of Latin America is clear in our DNA. So from the very beginning, 2001, we established Hispamar with our partner, Telemar. And since then, we are doing a terrific job trying to be there, as we are going to do today. With Amazonas 4A, we are going to respond to a double challenge. First of all, trying to provide in record time additional capacity when it's required, and it's required for football, of course. But we are going to do it in a very innovative and high quality services. We are going to be at the forefront of the revolution of the ultra high definition. We are trying to be part of the process of Latin America. We are really committed, and we try to really be faithful to this commitment. It's half of our life, more than half, because as Stefan has already said, we are being 25 years old this year, 13 years in Latin America. So it's clear that we are clearly Spanish, but we are American as well. And this positive development in these 25 years couldn't be possible without the support, the strong support and continued support of the public sector agencies in Spain that lead the way for a new era in Hispasat. We are starting with a new era with clear ambition and the determination of our main shareholder, Abertis, and I want to salute Abertis. We are going to work together in a very, very ambitious project in which we are going to really strengthen our capacity in Latin America, but in the Western of Europe as well, because we want to be really the bridge between Europe and Latin America. But we are working on opportunities to be a global player. Spain is back, Hispasat is back, and is trying to do its part. And it's time to congratulate everybody. It's time for gratitude as well. This is not only for shareholders, it's very important to have shareholders supporting the projects, but it's time to congratulate and to thank the professionals of Hispasat. Christina, you're here today, but there are many people around the world. Hola España, hola Arganda, Castellana, a toda la gente que está trabajando muy duro para que esto salga adelante. Obrigada, Brasil. Vamos a trabajar. We are going to work together in a very ambitious project, and without them, it couldn't be possible. So thank you to all the people of Hispasat. Secondly, the manufacturer. We were very exigent. We do it remarkably well. So thank you very much. With the highest standards, reliability, and service quality in record time. So thank you, Mr. Larkin, Mark, you're here. A special thanks to the Spanish industry. We maintain our commitment. We are including the most dynamic enterprises in Spain in our projects. We talk about it in the video. Thales Arianespace España, REMSA, JMB, Indra, and INSA. It is a privilege to work with you in this project for the future. And finally, Stefan, je dois remercier le lanceur Arianespace qui a mis les points.
I'd like to thank Arianespace that put the final touches on this project. And the wind, of course, is not their problem, but I would like to thank them for this exceptional professionalism, never disappointing the trust that we placed in this company. And I think the work that's been done justifies completely its prestige and its reputation. And this is why we very much hope that we will be able to continue to collaborate with Arianespace for our next satellite project.
Gracias a todos. And Spacet is here to write this story with you, with all of you. Thank you very much.
Good evening. Very good evening. First, on behalf of Orbital Sciences Corporation, I want to thank our customer, Elena Pisanero, Antonio Abad, Carlos Espinosa, and the entire Hispasat organization for putting their faith and trust in us to build the Amazonas 4A satellite. It was the first satellite we've built for Hispasat. Won't be the last, but it was the first, and it was an honor for us to be able to participate in this mission, so thank you. And now, over the next several weeks, we'll work on the satellite checkout. We also have another satellite under construction, and that with a lot of years, many, many, many years of on-orbit support, we hope to continue this long and what's been a very, very wonderful relationship that I think has been established with Hispasat. I'd also like to thank Stefan Israel and the entire Arianespace team for another great ride and your wonderful hospitality. As Stefan said, we've launched 25 satellites on Ariane rockets, and that represents roughly 70% of the Geostar satellites that we've launched. So we've had a long and very prosperous relationship, and we look forward to continuing that in the future. And finally, I'd also want to congratulate SES. It has been a very wonderful night. So thank you.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, speaking on behalf of the European Space Agency, I would like to start by congratulating the customers of this flight, because you have put your confidence in this launch system. And today you have seen a successful flight and you can put your satellites into business. So SAS, European Union, and also Hispasat, congratulations with this this success. I would like to thank the teams of Arianespace, the teams of industry, the colleagues of CNES and ESA for supporting again a successful Ariane 5 flight. We are really witnessing an outstanding performance of the launcher tonight again, and we are proud to be part of that. We are proud of something which started 50 years ago. 50 years ago we started a cooperation in Europe, also in the launcher business. And 50 years, by the way, is something that we are celebrating this year, 50 years of cooperation in space in Europe. And those 50 years have delivered us a series of successful launches, and even a launcher family that we have today with Ariane 5, Vega, the small launcher, and Soyuz operated here from Kourou. And that is a fantastic situation, but it's not the end of the story. Certainly not. We are continuing our efforts in Europe to develop new systems and improved systems. The member states of ESA have always been very supportive, committed to support the European launcher systems. And I think this is a very important signal for all the customers all over the world that this system is there to be used. But we are also working on the future. And this year, the year of 50 years cooperation in space, we will present proposals to our ministers by the end of this year, developing an improved system for Ariane 5, improved performance, but also the start of a development of a new launcher, Ariane 6. And on that basis, we can continue celebrating the evenings like tonight. We have a fantastic evening tonight, but we want to have also fantastic evenings in the future. And for that, these activities are crucial. Ladies and gentlemen, it was a great pleasure to be here tonight. It was a fantastic evening, and thank you again.
I would also like to say a few words, and I will not be long because we've heard several speeches this evening. We had our 59th success stories. This is indeed a record performance, and is also the result of very, very hard work by all of our partners and the teams for all these years. And so congratulations to all. And for our friends here in Guyana, I would like to say that Guyana is a very important partner for our space activities because we have our space center here, of course. So I would like to thank all of the elected officials and the local communities that are involved in the Guyana Space Center. And I would also like to greet our partners from the armed forces and the gendarmerie that protect us with a complete dedication and a sense of service that is outstanding and that ensure the safety of our facilities. But tonight's success is also the result of the trust and confidence placed in us by our customers. So I wish for this to thank them. And I know that when we signed the contract with Alain Martin, you said you could trust us. And I think that once again, we have justified the trust that you placed in us. And as Gail Winters said, Europe hopes to continue to provide satellite operators all over the world the very best possible launch services. And this is why we continue to work, all of us together, to prepare the next generation of launchers. And I think we even have a little drawing here to illustrate this. We do this so that you will come back as often as possible to the Guyana Space Center, which is the best in the world. And I say this not because we deserve it, but because you deserve it. I said I promised I would not be long. So once again, a bravo to everybody. Congratulations and thank you.
Okay, so I think it's time to conclude for tonight. Just to tell you that our next launch will be on April the 3rd. It will be a launch for the European Commission. It is the beginning of the deployment of Copernicus with the Soyuz. So we are very excited by this perspective, and we are working very hard to make it happen on time, so April the 3rd. So now, enjoy this evening. Thank you very much to all of you, and see you as soon as possible here in CSG. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup. Bonne soirée.
So, it's mission accomplished once again for Arianespace and the second launch this year. Congratulations to everybody who's worked so hard to put our two babies into space.
Yes, absolutely, Katie. And congratulations to our customers, SES and Hispasat, and to the manufacturing teams, Airbus Defence and Space and Orbital.
So our two satellites are now heading out on their journey to their final orbit. Best of luck to all the teams with the next phase of your operations. Thanks for joining us here live at the Guyana Space Center. From me, Katie Haswell.
And me, Claude Bernard. Goodbye. And thank you, Katie.